I find myself usually modifying the fragment shader in a program, since that's where all the per-pixel processing is happening. Let's back up a bit and show how various parameters were produced by the vertex shader. The position and normal of the vertex are passed in with these names, position and normal. A few built-in matrices are used for transformation, namely projection matrix, model view matrix, and normal matrix. In 3.js, these are always available to the shader if desired. In WebGL itself, you need to do a little more work. There's currently not a model view projection matrix of these two matrices multiplied together. Maybe you'll be the person to add it to 3.js, as it's commonly used and would be more efficient to use here. What we get out of this shader are a few vectors. First, the GL position is set, which is the location in clip coordinates. This vector must always be set by the vertex shader at a minimum. One of the features of the vertex shader is that you can change the shape of an object. You can't really change it in the fragment shader. The normal in model view space is computed here, using the normal transform matrix. Finally, a vector from the location in model view space toward the viewer is computed. First, the position in model view space is computed, and then negating this vector gives the direction toward the viewer from the surface, instead of from the viewer to object. Remember that the camera is at the origin in view space. We don't really need the temporary MV position vector. We could have combined these last two lines of code. This example is here to show how to compute it. To sum up, the vertex shader took as inputs the model space position and normal. It transformed them to create a point and clip coordinates for the rasterizer. It also transformed the normal and position. The resulting transformed vertices are then interpolated across the triangle during rasterization and sent to the fragment shader for each fragment produced.